Hey guys, it's Simon and welcome back to my libgdx Kotlin tutorial series. So in the last part we made some refactorings regarding the sealed classes for event management, and we also refactored a little bit the power-up system so it's solved in a more generic way and it's easier to add then new power-ups and actually combinations of different bonuses to the game. And in this part we're going to introduce, I think, almost the last system that we're gonna make in this tutorial series, and it's the camera shake system. Because currently when we are in the damage zone, from a player perspective, we don't know that something is happening. Later on, of course, when we add sound effects and maybe also the user interface, that we will see that the life is going down, but still it's a nice effect also for example for RPGs, when you have a critical strike, that the camera is shaking a little bit. And we want to introduce that today, so that when we are inside the damage area and we get damaged, we want to shake the camera a little bit. So to make that happen, first of all, of course, we need a system as usual, because almost everything in our game is part of a system. And let's call that camera shake system. And the camera shake system is actually not an iterating system, it's also not an interval system, it's just a generic entity system. So it's called, the update method is called every frame, but it does not do anything special. And the special thing that it needs to do is done by us, so that we shake the camera. And we come to that in a moment. And also what the camera shake system needs to know is when the player gets damaged, so therefore it's also a game event listener, so it's part of our event system that we implemented in the last few parts, and therefore we also need the game event manager, so that we can register ourselves to player damage events. So first of all, let's implement now the onEvent method. This one we're going to implement very soon. And also we override again the edit to engine and remove from engine. And when the system gets added, then we're gonna register ourselves as a listener. And the game event that we are interested in is the damage event that we do not have yet, but we're going to implement that very soon. So that will be then called player hit class, and we're going to add this system as the listener, and the same for the remove part. So remove listener, this player hit, as mentioned, is currently missing, so let's quickly add that. So it's just another subclass of our sealed game event classes. So player hit is a game event, and the information that it needs to have is first of all, so which player gets hit. Then we want to know how many life does the player entity have, and also what is the maximum life of the player entity. And as always, we override the toString method, similar as we did it already before. So that's it. And this is also for later on the event that we want to react to update also the HUD, so the user interface. And with the information of the life and the maximum life, we can actually then calculate, for example, for a player life bar, how big it is and so on. So, but that will come later on. So this is something for the future. And now we simply need to dispatch those hit events. So when is that happening? For that, we are going to our damage system. And after the player has taken damage, so here we're gonna dispatch the event. So also here, game event manager, we're gonna dispatch the event. The event will be the player hit event, and we want to set some properties. So the player, whoops, the player is the player that we have here. The life is from the player life, and the maximum life is also from the player, the maximum life. And this is not the entity. How is the entity called? It's just, okay, it's actually entity. Okay, so now whenever our player takes damage, we're gonna dispatch this event, and also if the shield would block it, so here at the top, we actually return. So if the player does not take damage but is in the damage area, then he blocked the damage amount with the shield, we're not going to dispatch this event, and also the camera will not shake. So in case the player would have, let's say, the maximum amount of shield, he can stay inside the damage area without taking damage, and therefore we are also not shaking the camera, because this is not, let's say, critical for the player. but once he is taking damage, then this event gets dispatched and then the camera starts to shake. So that's the principle behind that. Okay, then let's go back to our camera shake system. So now we have that with the player hit. Okay, so we have now the listener. So when the player gets hit, the camera shake system gets notified, and also we remove it accordingly. So this is the base for our camera shake system. What the system is also needing is the camera, so actually the game camera, because this is the one that we use then to make the shakes happening. The shakes, the smoothies. So with this system we're gonna make smoothies. No, let me draw that a little bit. So from a theory point of view, so this would be our game, and the red rectangle would be the viewport or the camera perspective, so what we see in the game. And to make a shake now happening, the only thing that we are doing is actually that we move the camera around its original position, so around its center. So the center would be here, and to make a shake for a player, we actually move it then randomly around, so a little bit of a distortion, let's say, away from the center of the camera. So it could be here, then down there, then up there, down there. And with this moving around, the game will then actually shake. It looks like a shaking. So this is what we are going to do. We just move the camera around a little bit around its center. This is the theory behind this shake system. And the way I implemented it is that I create a so-called camera shake instance. The camera shake instance has a certain duration, so how long is it going to shake the camera. And it also knows, it needs to know how much from the center it should move away. So how big should the shake be? Should it be just, I don't know, a quarter of world unit, then it would be very small shaking, or should it maybe be two world units, which would be around those areas here where it move around. And these camera shake instances can stack up, so up to I think 4 or 5 instances will be remembered in our shake system, and they are then just processed until no shake instances are left. Then the camera shake system will be idle. So if there are no camera shake instances, it does nothing, and if there are certain instances, then it does the camera shaking. And again, to avoid garbage collection, we're going to introduce a camera shake instance pool to pool those shake instances correctly. So coming back to our system, let's hide that here. We need now the camera shake instance that I was talking about. So let's call that the camera shake. And as mentioned, it's a poolable. What do we need to know within a camera shake? So as mentioned, we need to know the maximum distance that it goes away in world units from the center, so from the original position of the camera. And we need to know how long should it shake, so the duration of the shake. Then it definitely gets a camera passed in. So this is our game camera that we are then moving around. It needs to know the original position of the camera, because after the shake is finished, we need to return to the original position of the camera. So I did that within the update method, and it does that only once, so when the shaking is starting. So therefore we have a flag if the camera position should be stored. Then we actually store the original camera position, which is a vector 3. And we also need the current duration of the shake. And in the reset method, we simply reset everything to the original value. So max distortion is 0, duration is 0, current duration is 0. Then the original camera position is the vector 3, 0, and store camera position is also true. So that's the reset part. Now we're gonna implement the shaking actually, so the shake logic for the camera. So there we have an update method in our camera shake where we get in the delta time. And it returns a boolean. So if the shake is finished, it returns true. And if the shake is not finished, it returns false. So that one we need to know, so that we know when the shaking is actually done, then we can return this instance back to the pool and remove it from the processed list of camera shake instances. So the first thing we're going to check is, do we need to store the camera position? If yes, then we set this flag to false and we set the original camera position to the camera that you get in here and store the original position here. Then we check, is the current duration smaller than the maximum duration? Then we know the shaking is not done yet, so we are not over the maximum duration, so we want to do the shaking part. So here we calculate the power, so how strong should the camera shake. And this is the maximum amount that we want to move around in world units times the duration minus current duration divided by duration. So this is a value between 0 and 1. So current power in the end is then a value between 0 and maximum distortion. So the maximum amount that we want to move away, and it's a random value. It's not a random value. It's just when the duration goes on, then this part here becomes zero, closer to zero, and we're going back to the original amount. So at the beginning of the shake, it will be a high amount, let's say, and then it goes back to the original position of the camera slowly. So once we know the power of the shake, we can simply update the x and y coordinate of the camera position. So we are going to set camera position and we set the x value. And the x value is the original position times now a random value between minus 1 and 1 times the current power. And the same for the Y position. And whenever you update the camera position, you need to make a call to update. Because if you don't do that, then the position actually does nothing. So the position change here does nothing. Only with updates, the position really gets then updated. And at the end, we want to reduce the duration. We want to add the delta time there, so that once we are over the duration, we stop with our update. So in this case, we did something, the shake was happening and it's not done yet, so we return false. And here the current duration is greater than the duration, so the shake should be over. And what we need to do here, so we need to reset the camera position to the original position it had before the shake. We need to make the update call again. And now we know that everything is done, so we can return true and the camera shake is over. Okay, next thing that we are going to do is we need a camera shake pool. So this is poolable, but we need now a pool to correctly reuse instances of the camera shake. So we make a custom pool for that. Let's call that camera shake pool. This pool knows the game camera, so that it can pass it in to all the newly created instances of the camera shake. And it's a pool, which is a libgdx original class of type camera shake. So it creates camera shake instances. And what we need to do is implement the method new object. And the new object is simply a new camera shake instance. And the thing that we are going to initiate here is the camera. So from this instance, the camera is equal to the camera from our camera shake pool. It's assigned to itself, so let's rename that so that we don't have the name clashes. Game camera game camera. Okay, so this is our pool to create these instances. So we are almost done now for the system. So the only thing that we need now in our system itself is we're going to create an instance of our camera shake pool. We pass in the camera that we pass into the system, so the game camera. And we need a list of the active shake instances. So this is simply a GDX array again of camera shake. And now what we can do now, so when an event is happening, so in this case the player gets hit, we going to check if active shakes the size is smaller than 4. So this is the maximum amount of shake instances that we want to have. So if the player stays very long in the damage area, we want to stack up 4 camera shake instances, which will be processed then one after the other until all of them are done. So here you can play around with that. The higher the number, the longer the shaking is going to happen. And yeah, for this game, I chose the value of 4 because it felt nice. So if we did not reach the maximum amount yet, then to our active shake instances, we're gonna add a new shake instance, which we take from our pool. So there we call obtain to get a new instance. And we're gonna set some values then to this shake, which is the duration. The duration, I need to look up what I took. So let's say, for example, 1 second would be like this. So it should shake the camera for 1 second. And the maximum amount that it should place from the original, from the center of the camera, would be, I don't know, half of a world unit. But let me quickly check what kind of values I took there in the original game. Okay, so the shake duration is just a quarter of a second, and the distortion is also just a quarter of a world unit. Those were the values that I used in the final game, so let's go with that. And now the last thing that we need is to override the update method of our entity system. There we are going to check if the active shake instances are not empty. So there's something that we need to do. Then get the first instance or the first item from the array, so the first shake, update it, pass in our delta time. And if it returns true, we know that the shake is done, so we can remove it from the array. So active shakes, remove index 0. That would be the first instance there. And we also return it back to the pool. So free our shake instance so that we can reuse it later on. And that's it. So again, to summarize it, player gets hit. We're gonna register for this event. Then if we do not have more than 4 shaking instances already in our queue, then we're gonna add a new instance which gets pooled. So we take that out of the pool. If there are items in the pool, we reuse them. Otherwise, we create new instances. We set the duration and the maximum distortion of the shake in world units and in seconds. And in our update method, we simply check, do we need to do something? If yes, we update the first instance of or the first item of our queue. If it's done, so update returns true, then we remove it from the array and also send it back to the pool to reuse it later on. So that's the entire logic for the camera shake system. And now we only need to add it to our engine, to our entity engine. And there, after the damage system, we want to start the shaking, so we create here this camera shake system, and what we pass in is the game camera. So from our game viewport, the camera, and the game event manager. And that should already be it. So when we start now our game and we go into the damage area, we should see that the camera is a little bit shaking. So let's try to avoid the speed power-ups to test it properly. Again, the debug system would help here to immediately set it to the bottom. And as you see, now when we enter the damage area, the camera is shaking, and when we are out of it, so when the shaking is over, the camera stops. And now, from a player point of view, we would actually see, okay, here something is going pretty bad, so camera is shaking, this is not good. Let's go out of that damage area, and the shaking is stopping. And when we enter it again, it starts with the shake. Okay, that's it for this part. So this is how I implemented the camera shaking. I guess there are several other ways how you could do that. I did it that way, and you could also reuse that, as mentioned, for example, for an RPG. If the player lands a critical strike or something, then you can also, for example, use the camera shaking. So those are some common use cases for that. Okay, thanks for watching, and see you in the next part. Bye bye.